to welcome two television journalists from Hungary. They're both associated with MTV News, primetime news, and they're visiting the United States for 4 weeks as guests of the U.S. government. We welcome both of you gents. And then I want to remind everybody that following this briefing today, Captain Chris Rose, the F-16 pilot who is from the Washington, D.C. Air National Guard's 133rd Wing, he's the 1996 Collegian winner from the Air Force, and he's going to be here following this brief to give you a rundown on his experiences that led to that that award. Basically, he had a disabled jet, which I think many of you are aware of. He landed successfully after this in-flight emergency, and I think there is some video which they will, which the Air Force has, and can provide kind of a recap of what happened there. And with that, I will attempt to answer your questions.
Who else is participating in that briefing? Just the captain?
I can't answer your question. We'll we're off to a great start here. We'll see.
Captain, Congresswoman Carolyn Maloney today released a report on sex crimes in the military and alleged that sexual crimes are treated inconsistently and that a lot of service members are committing sex crimes and going unpunished and being put out into the general population without military records. Do you have any knowledge of that and any reaction to it?
I am aware that there has been some just very recent reporting on the release of such a report. We have not received it yet. But I'm sure we'll be most anxious to take a look at it. But I think it'd be premature for me to react to the report until we actually have had a chance to review it.
Has the military looked into the issue of sexual crimes in the military and how it's being?
Well, I think you're probably aware that there are a number of cases that have occurred over the years, which we've taken very specific action, some of which are going on right now. If you're talking about the totality of the issue, I'm not aware of any kind of a study that has been done DOD-wide, but I am aware that the Army has a review going on right now on the issue of relations between the sexes in the military, which is due sometime later this year.
There was a finding in this report that there were 40 to 50% more rapes committed in the military than in the general population.
I would think that probably is wrong, but again, I'd like to see the context in which that figure is given, and we'll see if we can provide some reaction to that once we've had a chance to look at the report. Yes.
On the same issue, the report does discuss sort of overall trends, and while I recognize you haven't seen the report, what the Congresswoman does is call for an independent commission to take a look at the military justice system based on a pattern that she sees of sort of the system's broken. What's your assessment of the military justice system? Is it working? Should there be a commission?
Well, again, Tammy, I think we're going to need to take a look at the report before anybody makes a reaction to it. Yeah.
Do you have any more information on the B-2s, the causes of the B-2 stand-down that was just announced?
I'm aware that there has been such a stand-down announced, but I don't really have any details. I think the Air Force will probably be in a position to provide more later this afternoon.
Captain, regarding the terrorist threats in Bahrain, it's reported that there are 1,000 U.S. personnel outside the capital at a 20-acre site, it's the capital of Manama. First, I would ask, is that perimeter of that particular base now completely secure from a vehicle bombing attack.
Bill, I think that it is not productive for me to get into the specifics of exactly what kinds of protective measures they've taken in Bahrain or any other place. I would like to point out that force protection has for many months now been receiving renewed and increased emphasis throughout the military, particularly in the Persian Gulf area. And the Deputy Secretary of Defense, John White, recently made a visit to that area, and one of the major issues he was reviewing during that trip was force protection measures. So I think it's probably in a very general way I can report to you that all of the bases that we visited in that region have taken some very significant measures of late. And the bases in Bahrain within the last few days have taken additional measures to increase the security of personnel. The measures that were taken in Bahrain in the last couple of days, I think, are being reported on a voice line, which is available to reporters, but they include the fact that we have restricted liberty. We've also placed off limits restaurants, clubs, and bars. And we'll keep those measures in effect for the foreseeable future.
Well, Mike, can you just outline what the nature of the threat that caused the U.S. to take these additional security precautions?
Well, I think you're aware that there have been some indicators over the last several weeks which have heightened concerns there. And again, without getting too specific, I just want to point out that there have been there has been an increased flow of information from a variety of sources, including, by the way, from press reports, which have led the officials there to take these increased security measures.
Captain,
what were those?
Excuse me?
You said that, as you know, but what are you referring to? What reports are you referring to? What indicators?
Well, I'm referring to both intelligence indicators and also press reporting.
Of what, though?
Of threats being made against particularly U.S. military personnel in the region.
Is this New York Times account correct when it says the United States has uncovered the outlines of a terrorist plan by dissidents to attack American troops stationed in the country?
You know, we don't discuss intelligence in any great detail. I want to leave it just exactly where I have it right now, which is that we have a continuing flow of information that has led individuals there who are in a position of responsibility to take increased security measures.
And can you make any comment to the bottom line in Elaine Scalino's article about the Bahrainian Party of God having connections to Shiite dissidents in Saudi and all the way to the financing of the Party of God by Iran? Can you make any comment about
that?
No,
I can't make any comment on that particular conclusion that she's reached. Yes.
Could you run the numbers down for us? How many U.S. personnel are in Bahrain? How many civilian U.S. and whether there's any thought of thinning down the force or any kind of rescue?
Well, I don't have the numbers with me right now, except that there are about 1,000 U.S. military personnel who are ashore or shore-based there in Bahrain. And there are no considerations right now being given to sending dependents home.
But that 1,000... That doesn't include the dependents, so we're multiply that by three or four?
Well, I think we can probably get a more specific number for you. I just don't happen to have it up here on the podium today. But why don't we, I think if you check with Lieutenant Colonel Savini, he can give you a more refined number after the brief here. Just 1 second, yeah.
This 1,000 personnel, that's at the headquarters of the 5th Fleet, correct? Is that still there?
Yes. The headquarters of the U.S. 5th Fleet is there in Manama. And these are individuals who are associated with the 5th Fleet and with other support activities that are located there.
Mike, we know you have one Navy ship there right now in port at Bahrain. Have other Navy ships been told not to go to the area for a while?
The number of port visits will be limited for the immediate future as a result of these increased security measures.
By limited, you mean, can you elaborate a little bit?
I can't get any more specific than that right now.
So they're still allowed to come for certain reasons, but you're not banning any more?
Well, problems. But what I said was that we've restricted liberty.
I understand.
Not the port visit. So in cases where an upkeep might be required.
But the Manawa headquarters, 5th Fleet headquarters, personnel can go into Manawa and travel about, not to go to the restaurants, but they can go around the country. Is that correct, even though liberty is banned and further visits by Americans are banned, still those personnel at the base can?
Bill, I don't want to split hairs because I have not provided to you every detail about what personnel there have been given in the way of guidance. And the reason I haven't done that is because I don't want to show my hand to others who might be looking to take advantage of that situation.
I appreciate it.
Yeah. Yeah, Tammy?
Are there additional security forces being sent to Bahrain?
I am not aware of any additional numbers. I would point out to you that there are a number of Marines who have been sent to Manama since the Khobar Towers bombing. And those Marines are very much in evidence, as anyone who's visited the area knows.
Is that a FAST team that's there?
I think that may be how they're characterizing it. I'm not sure that that's necessarily the full title of the organization. Yeah. Just a second. Have we finished that one?
Yeah. Rough numbers, how many Marines?
I don't know. Again, I think Colonel Savini can probably give you that.
Dozens or hundreds?
I don't want to hazard a guess. It's more than dozens, though. Yes. Okay. Another one? Yeah.
Topic. On the QDR, there's we almost do by the 15th, but there have been some reports that it may come out early. Do you have anything firmer on that as to when there may be a briefing in here on the QDR results?
Don't have any detail on the exact schedule of the rollout, but I think we should have more for you on that by the probably by the early part of May.
It looks like it won't be the 15th per se. It could be earlier.
Well, what I'm saying to you is that I don't have a full schedule on the rollout now, but the rollout is going to coincide with the delivery of the report to the Hill. So it's very much tied to that.
Mr. Sergeant?
Yeah.
The magazine Naval Institute Proceedings, in its last issue, proposes for the DNC in case of conflict between Greece and Turkey, separation of the Greek and Turkish forces by maritime green line, deployment of multinational force under UN auspices, creation of a new status quo by an international conference, and a final partition of the Aegean via EMEA judicial process. Any comment, since this publication is related to the Pentagon?
I would just like to point out that although the publication is widely read in the Pentagon, it is not an official publication of the Pentagon or of the United States Navy. The purpose of the publication is to express the personal and sometimes provocative views of the authors of those articles. And that's the way that this article and any other article should be taken.
The Greek magazine Nemesis is organizing a music festival in Imi Islet of the Aegean on May 25th in order to clarify the status quo ante. I'm wondering if you are still monitoring the Imi area and how.
When we talk about monitoring an area, including this area, we talk about doing so by maintaining contact and conversation with the appropriate officials of the various governments involved in the region. We do not necessarily mean that we have eyes on the area, and I think that monitoring of the situation, including the one that you've just outlined there, is best described as keeping contact with the people who are in a position to know about events there.
And the last one, Captain, the Turkish embassy yesterday circulated the news item that the U.S., the Pentagon actually, agreed finally with Israel and Turkey to have joint military exercises in the Eastern Mediterranean. And I'm wondering, number one, if you included the Aegean Sea too, and number two, if the Israeli Minister of Defense the other day discussed this matter here at the Pentagon.
I am not aware of any kind of discussion of that particular issue, and what's more, I'm not aware of the exercise that you're talking about. Yeah.
Do you have any kind of update on this missing A-10, as far as what's happened to the U-2 data? Has that been released yet?
Well, the U-2 data, I understand they're still reviewing. This is a situation where the aircraft has been missing since the 2nd of April, which was last Wednesday. It was in a flight of three A-10s that were on a training mission at the Barry Goldwater training range near Gila Bend, Arizona. There has been an extensive search which has been underway ever since then. Thus far, we have not found any evidence of the aircraft, but we're continuing to search, including an area now that extends up into southwestern Colorado.
What theory are you operating under here about what might have happened to this plane?
I'm not sure that we're operating under a theory other than the fact that the aircraft has gone missing and we're trying to locate it. I don't think anybody at this point has a good enough idea of what occurred with the aircraft to have come up with any kind of a theory as to what might have caused it to go missing.
Do you have any reason for why it was so far off course where it was supposed to be, apparently, over the area by Telluride, Colorado?
No, at this point, I don't have any good reason for why the aircraft might have gone so far astray.
Mike, it's back to the QDR. You mentioned that the rollout will be in May, coincident with when it goes to Congress. Can you confirm various reports that not all the QDR will be in hand at that time, but you may hold out sections such as those on the reserves until after May 15th deadline?
Let me just give you a – I believe that the Secretary actually talked about this issue with some of the media that he has been traveling with, and what he told them was the report will be filed on time and it will be inclusive. He went on to say he didn't want to leave anyone with the impression that any component of the QDR will be missing from the report.
Back to the A-10 problem. I mean, the mystery of what happened to this plane, I mean, is there any indication or any evidence that anything sinister or untoward has happened to this plane? I mean, could it have been shot down? Could it have been stolen by the pilot? Is there any evidence of anything other than just some sort of mechanical malfunction or problem with the pilot?
Well, there at this point, what we know is that the aircraft is missing, that the last time that it was seen was at 11:58 a.m. Mountain Standard Time on April the 2nd. But beyond that, since we have not found any evidence of the aircraft or of the pilot, we don't have a good idea of what has occurred with the aircraft.
Did the pilots of the other two A-10s it was traveling with give any indication of what they thought happened to the plane?
I am not aware of any indicators that they've given at this point. There was a track which was developed in which the U-2 flew, which led up into Colorado. And the purpose of that flight was to see if the U-2 could uncover any evidence of the aircraft on that track.
Did they make it anything of the fact that this pilot apparently often flew training missions to Colorado?
No, I don't think that that is necessarily relevant in this particular case.
And one last question on this. Are criminal investigators from CID looking into this case at all?
Not that I'm aware of.
One other thing.
This is another A-10. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
My question was, assuming that you don't find it, when do you stop looking? I mean, is there a cutoff date?
Well,
I would assume there's a lot of assets that are being used to try.
Well, there are a lot of assets. We've got the Civil Air Patrol units from Colorado. We've got units from the Arizona Army National Guard. We've got the 162nd Air National Guard from Tucson. We've got an EC-130 Airborne Battlefield Command and Control Center aircraft. We've got that U-2 from the 9th Reconnaissance Wing at Beale. The whole effort is being coordinated by the Air Force Rescue Center at Langley Air Force Base here in Virginia. Now, I can't forecast for you when the search might be suspended. We never totally suspend looking for any kind of a missing aircraft until we have evidence of what might have occurred. But I'm not sure that the full range of assets that are presently being applied to the search will continue indefinitely.
Mike, are the severe weather conditions over Colorado hampering search efforts right now?
Well, the situation there is, of course, in that part of the state at this time of year, there are a lot of the terrain is covered by snow. My understanding is that there's been snowfall since the aircraft went missing, which no doubt could frustrate the efforts to find the aircraft. Yes, Suzanne.
One other question. There's an analogy made to the movie Broken Arrow in a report yesterday. Given all of the assets involved in this search, is there any reason to believe that this aircraft was ditched and its weaponry stolen?
There is absolutely no reason to think that.
Are those apparently one of the concerns about the plane is that it did have live bombs on board. Could those bombs be accidentally detonated or detonated by somebody else if they were to fall into the wrong hands?
I would have to get you a real expert, but I can tell you that the bombs that were on that aircraft were designed to be dropped from an aircraft. They would, by the way, I am also told they are also designed so that they would not detonate if the aircraft crashed.
Two questions.
Yeah.
One, have you confirmed the reports that people heard the plane in Colorado?
I don't think that we have good confirmation that this particular plane was heard over Colorado.
Isn't this a mystery? There have been civilian planes that disappeared and were found years later, but have you ever heard of a military plane that just disappeared? Nobody heard about it in a year.
In fact, I think you might want to talk with the Air Force, but there are cases where aircraft disappear in the winter and then turn up sometime later after the snows have melted.
Yeah. As far as you know, this plane and this pilot were equipped with the typical beacons, or were they equipped with the typical beacons that would be used if they went down, signals and those sorts of things?
I think you want to talk to the Air Force about what triggers the beacons. The aircraft and the pilot have the normal beacon systems. I'm just not certain whether you have to eject from the aircraft in order for the beacon to be activated. Yes?
On Albania, according to a report, the Italian government expressed today its great concerns about the unpredictability of the military mission in Albania because much of the country is controlled by rebel groups and criminal gangsters. Are you planning to deploy forces too, and how do you protect your interests in Albania without military presence?
Are we planning to deploy forces to Albania? The answer is no, we are not planning to deploy forces to Albania. We have, I think there are 100 plus or minus a few Marines which are providing security at the embassy in Tirana, but we have no plans to deploy any additional forces, and as soon as the security can be arranged through other means, we'll be bringing those Marines out of Albania. Yeah.
Just one more quick one on the A-10. I guess it was Friday before last, another A-10 crash on landing up in Willow Grove Naval Air Station, I believe. Would the Pentagon be looking at maybe trying to find out what happened, or what was the cause of that crash, and trying to determine maybe what happened here?
I'm frankly not aware of that one. You might want to check with the Air Force and see if they have anything for you on that aspect of it. Yes, Suzanne?
Different subject. Yep. Just an update on Africa, if there's been any change in the deployment there.
The situation that's right. Actually, though, the U.S. Military personnel who are associated with that operation are not in Zaire. Situation is that we've got the USS Nassau still off the coast with the Marines embarked. There are about 256 military personnel in Brazzaville in the Republic of the Congo, and over 100 in Libreville in the Republic of Gabon. Some of the special operations people who were originally there to provide the evacuation capability have redeployed and are now back in their home stations. Others are in the process of redeploying, and over the next days and weeks, the European command will be finalizing their plans to kind of make adjustments in the number of troops that are deployed in the region now that the Nassau and the Marines have are in position off the coast.
How many Americans are left in Zaire, just American citizens, do you know?
I don't have a good figure with me up here. I'm sure we've got that back on the desk, and you, after the brief, you can check. Yeah.
And to Korea, to North Korea.
Just a second. Do we have anything else on that one? Good.
Okay. Congressman Tony Hall on tour in North Korea is reporting North Korean soldiers showing signs of being decimated themselves by the famines, he states, I think, also North Korea is rapidly descending into a hell of severe famine. My question would be, what is the impression of the Department of Defense regarding these reports, and secondly, what is the position, the policy of the Department of Defense regarding feeding North Korean troops?
Well, first of all, I think that it's widely acknowledged that there are severe food shortages which are affecting the DPRK at this point. With regard to the feeding of the North Koreans, that really is a matter that you need to talk to the State Department. I think you're well aware that we have provided some assistance in that regard and I am not aware of any kind of modification to that.
And is the Defense Department seeing this crisis, this famine crisis, as urgent so far as getting more food to the north more quickly, or do you have any particular perspective on that?
I don't really have any perspective for you on that one. Yeah, Jamie.
A recent Time magazine article suggested that the Pentagon favors lifting the ban on foreign military sales to some South American countries because of the positive changes in the governments down there. Can you comment on whether or not that reflects the view of Secretary Cohen, as reported in the Time magazine piece?
What I just want to point out with you on the Time magazine piece is I think it was wrong in several different respects. One, authority that was granted to aircraft companies essentially allowed them to provide technical data in this particular instance where there is a decision forthcoming on an aircraft buy. It did not allow the sale of any aircraft. And the other thing I'd like to point out is that there's been no decision by the President regarding that issue. And the issue is still in a matter of discussion.
But has Secretary Cohen recommended that the ban be lifted?
I think at this point we will just leave it where I've put it, and we'll not talk about what his recommendations will or won't be with the President on that issue.
On your first point, when you say that was just to allow the U.S. companies to provide technical data to
right.
the governments.
So that a bid could occur.
So a bid could occur. But in the cases where United States companies eventually do win a bid in that circumstance, don't they almost always then get approval for the sales to go forth?
I don't have any historical perspective for you on that. Anybody else? Yes.
Chinese Foreign Ministry spokesman responded somewhat negatively to the Secretary Cohen's remarks on the weekend that the 100,000 U.S. troops in the region were not aimed to containing China. Anyway, so this spokesman said, we believe Asian nations should preserve the peace and stability of the Asian region. And also he said, we believe Asian nations are fully capable of doing so. Do you have any response?
I'd just like to point out that we have maintained a forward presence in that region of the world for many, many years. Our presence there has added to the stability of the region. We're there at the invitation of the governments of Japan and the government of the Republic of Korea. And the Secretary has indicated every intention of maintaining that forward presence in that part of the world for the foreseeable future.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay. Now, before everybody departs the scene, let me just move to the next section here. And are you going to do this, Colonel Privola? I'll turn the proceedings over to Colonel Virginia Privola, who is the individual who arranges briefings for the U.S. Air Force. Colonel Privola.
Thank you,
the floor
sir.
Is yours.
Thank you. We're pleased to have with us today Captain Chris Rose, a pilot for the D.C. Air National Guard's 113th Wing, and his fiancée, Jackie, and also to have here today his Collegian Award, which he has been presented in a private ceremony yesterday by General Ron Fogelman. General Fogelman said yesterday, Captain Rose's outstanding airmanship skills and calm demeanor saved a $20 million aircraft and perhaps many lives. He exemplifies the caliber of professionals who serve in today's Air Guard, Reserve, and active duty force. As you heard, the trophy is given to an air crew member who most successfully coped with an in-flight emergency. Now, I'd like to read his citation, which will tell you how superbly he handled what could have been a very deadly situation. Captain Christian H. Rose distinguished himself on June 27, 1996, while assigned to the 113th Fighter Wing, District of Columbia Air National Guard, Andrews Air Force Base, Maryland. While part of a four-ship formation of F-16s on a training mission, the engine of Captain Rose's jet began to vibrate violently, then failed entirely. He and his flight turned to head toward an emergency airfield. Unable to see the field due to cloud cover, Captain Rose received course guidance from his flight leader. After jettisoning his external fuel tanks, Captain Rose executed a near-perfect flame-out landing on a 7,000-foot runway. Most of you will remember the footage, the gunship footage, that the networks aired right after Captain Rose's suspenseful landing. But we've taken that video today and enhanced it with computer graphics to recreate the flight from the wingman and ground-level perspectives to give you a better idea of just what Captain Rose did that earned him this distinguished award yesterday. We never leave well enough alone. So y'all want to roll the video? Your props.
Copy that.
How about giving us the Elizabeth City Tower frequency 1 or 2? Stand by.
And 41 maintain 1-4,000.
Warning.
Maneuvering with Bully 4. He's engine problem. He's on our nose now. I'm squawking emergency. We'll be following him to Elizabeth City.
We're gonna descent now. You're 7 miles, 9,000.
Center one altitude, just a bullet set.
Made it below, dude.
Washington, what's the frequency for Elizabeth City Tower?
Warning.
Engine out landing at Elizabeth City, Bully 4.
Hey, VHF 355.6, Bully 4, 355.6.
Elizabeth City Tower.
Bully 4, it's off to your left.
Coming in.
4.
Engine out, landing on runway 28 or 0.
Come left now, 4. It's about 20 degrees left.
Your runway 1.
4 is in sight.
Here's the wind favored runway 070 at 5. The altimeter is 3013. Report 5 miles.
Okay, he's engine out. His engine has failed. He's coming in. No engine. Do you copy?
You copy.
Okay, 4. If you're reading 3 on Victor, you're cleared to land on the east.
Copy that. I got you on Victor, landing east-west.
Roger.
And engines failed. No start.
Okay.
Stay the winds.
You want to jettison your tanks? Go ahead and get your tanks off now. Okay, tanks are off. 1, mark those tanks.
1's got to mark.
Gear's coming down.
Elizabeth City, he's turning a right base now. Understand he's cleared to land on the runway 10.
Craft calling, affirmative. Any runway is fine. Runway 10 is clear. Wind 070 at 5. Clear to land.
Okay, he is an emergency. He has engine out, his gear is down, he's short final.
Good, got 3 green.
You're doing good, you got 3 green, you look good.
Zero 034, Roger, continue inbound.
Good job, 4. Now get it stopped.
She'll stop, no problem. Thanks for the help.
Good job.
I'm sure you're all anxious to ask Captain Rose a few questions, so at this time I'd like to introduce the award winner of this year's Collegian Award, Captain Rose.
How are you doing today? I'd like to make a couple opening remarks. First off, I want to just say how honored I am to receive this award. It's a very coveted award, and by me especially. I met the Collegian family yesterday, and meeting them and knowing them makes it even a more special award for me. And I was also presented the award by the Chief of Staff of the Air Force, General Fogelman, and that was quite an honor, in the presence of the Secretary of the Air Force, Sheila Widnall. So for me, that was a very big honor. And another thing, the flight members, you heard them on the tape, they were a big part of this, and they deserve a lot of credit. Any questions? Yes.
I was just struck listening to you how calm you seemed. I mean, what were you feeling? Were you freaking out beneath it all, or?
Not really. What I was thinking was I was very focused, a lot of decisions that I was making. One of the reasons I sound so calm, I like to think, is because my element lead, Lieutenant Colonel Vince Chaban, was the one you heard talking a lot. I didn't have to talk, and if I did talk a lot, I don't know how I would have sounded, but I was because I was so focused on doing what I was doing.
How close were you to punching out?
That was always an option that I kept. As I got closer to the field and saw the airport, that became less of an option. But it was always an option. Throughout the entire approach, I was in the, what they call the ejection envelope. There was a safe to eject at any time.
From the time of flame out to the time of touchdown, what was your distance from the field? What maneuvers did you have to make to get online for that landing? And how hot were you when you came on, come down on it?
I was about 13,500 feet and about 15 miles from the airport. I turned a little bit to the right to go around some clouds that were beneath me. I couldn't see the airport right in the initial phase of this. I was going in the direction I thought it was, and then finally you heard my flight members giving me some more guidance as to which way it was. So I turned a little right, and I came out at about 45-degree angle to the airport, and I had to make a slight right turn when I saw it.
How is this different from a normal landing, a powered landing, as far as your ground speed?
It's the approach is much steeper and much faster. It's about 50 knots faster, about 60, 70 miles per hour faster.
Which was?
I'm sorry. My approach speed was about 225 knots, 230 miles per hour, and I touched down at close to 200 miles per hour.
And just use brakes?
Just use the emergency backup brakes, yes.
What's the normal compared to the 200 miles an hour?
We normally touch down at about 130.
Ever happened before?
To me, I've been flying this airplane for over 1,000 hours, over 4 years, and I've never had even a minor emergency until this, and still haven't.
And what was the cause of flame up?
It was a mechanical failure of the engine, just an internal failure.
Any other
questions? That's you had 15 miles. Wasn't there ever any time that you were thinking, I may not make this? I mean, this may not work.
The things that were really going through my head, you heard my altitude and my distance from the airport. Based on our training, we know the glide range of the airplane. And those numbers, I was just constantly doing math. Can I make it? Before I saw the airport, I'm thinking, you heard him say, I'm, 9,000 feet, 7 miles. I know I can make that under favorable circumstances. And that's the kind of thing I was thinking. So, and once I saw it, it was just a matter of perception.
You were trained to handle this situation?
Absolutely. We trained for this on a regular basis. I was just at Edwards Air Force Base about 6 months prior to that doing some advanced training. And on a regular basis when we fly, we do that sort of approach.
Now,
yes.
This wasn't your intended airstrip, though, right?
No, it wasn't. Yeah. This was a briefed backup emergency airfield. We talk about it. It's right near a bombing range, and that's our backup airfield. And we brief it every time before we fly. We talk about what backup airfields we'll use, where they are, things like that. So I was well aware of where it was and that I would go there.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Yes, sir.
Did you ever think about the fact that you were flying a $20 million plane?
Not at the time. I think about that every day. But not at the time. That wasn't. I think about that when I train. I think about that when I fly. that it's an expensive airplane, and I do my best to maintain my proficiency, as does every other pilot.
How much credibility are you giving to the single-engine plane?
Like I said, that's the only fighter airplane I've flown, and I love the F-16. I wouldn't trade it for any other airplane in the world.
Strike fighter?
No, I love the F-16. Thank you. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I think some of you have already realized that we have 45 West Point cadets here today. They're visiting as part of a public speaking course. We also have Ben Stanley, who is a senior from Parker High School in Janesville, Wisconsin. He's part of the Washington Seminar Program. With those welcomes, I'll try and answer your questions. Jamie.
Mike, can you shed any light at all on this report by some airline pilots that they believe they saw a missile on the night of March 17th? And can you confirm whether or not it might be possible that that was any sort of scheduled missile test?
Jamie, I can't shed any light on the report. I think you'll have to talk to the NTSB for details about what they may be looking into with regard to the report.
Can you confirm that the Navy fired two missiles that night?
Indeed, off the coast of Florida, there were missiles fired in connection with a test that was being conducted, Trident missiles. But I don't really see any connection between a flight which is out of New York City and a missile test off the coast of Florida.
Well, if the planes were flying out of New York, and apparently they were over about Philadelphia at the time, and they were looking south-southeast in the direction of where this missile test took place off the coast of Florida, and they're at 30,000 feet, and this is a very high-flying intercontinental ballistic missile, do you know if it's possible at all they were looking in the right direction at the right time to have seen this missile?
Jamie, I think it stretches the imagination to believe that anybody could see a distance of 1,900, 2,000 miles, no matter what altitude they're flying at. Keep in mind that this missile test off the east coast of Florida was basically in a north, but primarily eastern direction toward the Azores. The pilots were flying in a westward direction. So I'm not, again, I think it stretches the imagination to think that pilots could have seen this particular test. I don't claim to know what they would have seen. It just seems to me that the test that was conducted that day off the east coast of Florida has any relationship to what the pilots may have seen.
And one more general question. What does the military, the Pentagon do, the military do in terms of conducting missile tests to ensure that they don't interfere with civilian aviation or mariners at sea or even populated areas of land?
Jamie, there's a process that any military unit that is conducting tests like this goes through, and it involves filing what is called a notice to mariners. And this is a notification so that pilots, mariners, even people who might be affected on the ground are notified that there is going to be such a test. And there is coordination between the unit and the FAA so that the areas in which such a test is going to be conducted, it can be assured that there is not going to be any kind of conflict with civilian air traffic or any other kind of traffic that may be going on. And then, of course, during the course of the test, the flight is monitored so that if there's a problem, the missile can be destroyed prematurely if necessary.
Do you know if such documentation exists that could be brought forth, made public?
Documentation
that notification was made.
The notum. The notams are a matter of public record, so I'm sure that they're on file someplace. And the FAA is the body that normally files those.
Do you limit missile tests to certain areas where they
There are certain areas off the East Coast where such tests are conducted, and they are. There's a range off of the eastern and southern part of Florida is one example that I'm aware of. There's some in the Caribbean where tests are conducted. There's some out in the Pacific. But generally speaking, they're in areas that are not high traffic areas where traffic will not be interrupted by such tests.
This may sound a little silly, but does the military ever conduct missile tests either in busy air corridors or over populated areas of the United States?
No, they don't. And there are, it again, stretches the imagination to think that the military would be involved in any kind of a missile test around New York City.
General Estes was talking about a big review after the TWA crash of whether any military assets could have been involved. Do you know if that came up with an explanation of all these reports of missile sightings?
I am not familiar with the review that you're talking about, but I am also not aware of any kind of military involvement in that episode either. Yes.
Tell us about the A-10, the lost A-10 aircraft.
The search is still going on, and will continue until we have further information about what has happened to the aircraft. I think that a lot of you have already been reporting that the area of the search has been extended up into southwestern Colorado, an area where there is a lot of snow cover at present, where there has been an accumulation of snow since the aircraft disappeared. And it is possible that that is playing some role in our ability to find the aircraft at this point. But we really don't have any further details.
Is the assumption that the plane crashed and the pilot is dead?
Well, at this point, I think it's... it is best to say that we're still conducting the search. We don't know what happened to the aircraft. We don't know what happened to the pilot, and we'll continue looking until we get answers to those questions.
New subject.
Sure.
Can you say, though, is the military looking into the pilot's personal background to determine whether, not so much that this aircraft was stolen, but that he used it to commit suicide?
I don't know that is the case. I would refer you to the Air Force for any information on that aspect of the search. Joe?
Relationship to Guantanamo Bay, there's a report that the U.S. is letting down its guard, removing mines from the area immediately surrounding the base. Can you tell us if that's true and why it's being done?
Joe, what I know about that is that this is a part of a multi-year program to explode aging mines down there at Guantanamo Bay in Cuba. The U.S. Marine Security Forces down there have been conducting these detonations. This was a program which was actually in place before the presidential directive, and at the time it was planned for completion by the year 2000. As it is right now, we anticipate that we will, by stepping up the clearance activity, we'll have all of the mines eliminated by the end of 1999.
Are the mines actually being detonated, or are they?
Yes, they're actually being detonated.
New
yes.
Topic?
Sure.
Just one thing on the mines. Are other areas around the world, except for the DMZ and Korea?
I'm not aware of other areas where we have a mine field except along the DMZ in Korea.
With the removal of those mines, is there going to be any increase in the number of personnel assigned to Gitmo for security?
Let us take that question. I'm not aware of any increase, but that's a good question. We'll get you an answer.
How is the security being assured with these mines coming out?
Well, you know, we have a number of perimeter security measures down there, which include personnel, U.S. Marine Corps personnel, and those, of course, remain in place down there.
Do you know what the Cuban security deployment or array looks like on the other side of the line?
I don't, but I think the people at the Atlantic Command could probably give us a rundown on that. We'll take that one, too, and see if we have some kind of description that we can give you. Okay. Let's just go back.
Topic?
Yeah.
Yesterday, we all saw Lockheed Martin unveiled their F-22 down in Georgia with a lot of dignitaries from Washington on hand. Do you know if any of the congressmen or senators were transported down there on military aircraft? If so, how many, which ones?
I believe that they were, but I'd refer you to the Air Force for details on the transportation arrangements.
Another subject?
Yeah.
Is on here?
Okay. Zaire.
Yeah. With the increasing political turmoil, what does it look like now, whether or not U.S. forces will have to go evacuate U.S. citizens?
Well, I don't want to make any predictions on what it looks like, but I can tell you that we'll take our signals from the State Department, from the ambassador, who will determine if there is a requirement for U.S. military personnel to be involved in any kind of an evacuation of U.S. citizens. Right now, we have about 243 military people in Brazzaville in the Republic of the Congo and about 169 in Libreville, which is in Gabon. We've got USS Nassau with about 1,300 Marines off the coast of Zaire, and the Marines and military people in Brazzaville and Libreville are standing by and at the ready in the event that they're called upon to help out. But right now, they're in a wait-and-see mode.
Are any of the Marines on shore?
Yes, there are about 100 Marines who have gone ashore. And I think they are in Brazzaville.
What are they doing there?
Well, they are providing the kind of communications and security that you would expect if there were going to be any kind of an operation. All of that, it would be important to have set up in advance rather than waiting until a decision were made.
Are they included in that 243
yes,
number?
Yes, they are.
And have they been put on any higher alert or brought in any more air assets for possible
alert? No, I'm not aware that their alert status has been moved up any, but keep in mind that the whole purpose of their presence there is to be ready to go in the event that their assistance is required, and as a result, they're at a very high state of awareness and preparedness for this kind of an operation. Joe?
The CIA has apologized for its handling of the investigation concerning the Gulf War illness, indicating that they apparently had a breakdown in communications. Still, critics are saying what was released indicates what they've been saying all along. This is why we are sick. This is how we got sick. How is this building responding to those claims today?
Well, Joe, I just point out that we have a very extensive program underway right now to try and get some answers to the many unanswered questions regarding the illnesses which are afflicting Gulf War veterans. The programs that we have underway include medical research, include contacting those who were in various parts of the Kuwaiti theater of operations to get their insights into what may have occurred. But from what was released yesterday, does not really add to our understanding of the illness itself. It certainly does add to our understanding of the operations that may have gone on, the intelligence assessment of what the environment may have been in connection with Camisea, but it does not relate to the illness itself. Mr. Lamb.
Yes. As I asked you before yesterday, the Turkish embassy circulated that your Department of Defense accepted finally the Israelis' proposal for a joint military exercise with Israel and Turkey in the Eastern Mediterranean. Could you please confirm this information?
As I understand it, you're asking if there is an exercise involving Turkey and Israel, which the U.S. will also participate in. Is that correct?
That's correct.
My understanding is that there is a proposal for such an exercise that we are right now in the process of considering the timing and the scope of an exercise, but it is not gone beyond that.
So far, this is not something on a permanent basis to do that as long as the agreement exists between the other two countries.
There is, if there is such an exercise, we are willing to participate in it, but the timing and the scope of the exercise has not yet been determined.
But, Captain, it was reported that in this agreement, Turkey and Israel included also illegally the Greek island of Gavdos, G-A-V-D-O-S, which is located south of the island of Crete. Since you are going to participate, as you said, could you please confirm this information?
I am certainly not aware that that island is involved in the exercise. And since we're still looking at the parameters of the exercise, I can't really go any further than that.
But did you see the context of the agreement between the two countries?
I don't know that it involves that island at all.
Thank you.
Like the
incident.
Korea. Could you put into some context the shooting incident that occurred, I guess, earlier today or yesterday?
This was an incident which occurred on Thursday, Korea time, as I understand it. it involved a very few North Korean soldiers, and I don't have a specific number for you, who were armed with rifles, who crossed over the DMZ very, very briefly. There were some shots that were fired by the soldiers from the Republic of Korea side, and the North Korean soldiers ran back over to their side. We think that this is an isolated incident, and we certainly don't view it as any kind of threatening event.
Was there an exchange of gunfire, or would you classify these as warning shots fired by
I you? Think I would say warning shots, and not exchange of gunfire, although there was a sequence to it. But my understanding of the events is that the shots were actually fired into the air, which is kind of standard in these situations, which have occurred before, I might point out.
How
often? With enough regularity that we don't view them as particularly threatening.
Do they indicate anything? a dissatisfaction on the part of the North Koreans with something?
I think that would be reading way, way, way too much into this situation.
Can I go to another topic?
Sure.
Thank you. Captain, concerning the article that Bill Gertz wrote about China, he was reporting about a report from U.S. intelligence officials and China analysts that Mr. Spence, Floyd Spence, was quoted here as saying, Chinese leaders have said we are the enemy, the United States, that is, and stand as a major roadblock, checking their desire to dominate East Asia. And Mr. Spence goes on to say that the report that is being reported on here says as much. Could you, for the Department of Defense, comment on China's buildup, military buildup, especially their intelligence activities in the U.S., looking for our technology, our military technology, and their basic weapons buildup?
Bill, what I would propose is that we provide to you a copy of this report, which is being circulated now, and it goes into quite a bit of detail on China in various aspects. This was a report which was required by the Congress. They now have it in hand, and I think we can probably provide you a copy of it to answer those questions.
Can you say anything with regard to Mr. Spence's comments quoted here directly, saying that the Chinese believe the U.S. is the enemy? Is this military see it that way?
I think that I would like to point out to you that we have a policy of engagement right now with the Chinese. You've seen a manifestation of that in the port visits that were recently conducted by Chinese vessels in San Diego and in Hawaii. We will continue to pursue this policy of engagement, which we think is the appropriate approach to take.
I see. And the former CIA director was quoted in this, the previous CIA director was quoted as saying that the sale of Chinese arms continues to be inappropriate in the eyes of the U.S. insofar as far as proliferation of their sophisticated weaponry.
Well, we certainly have expressed on several occasions our concerns regarding certain arms sales that are being made by the Chinese, and I think that our response in all of those instances is well known and a matter of record. The report that I referred to earlier is up on the Hill now, and we can make sure that you have a point of contact so we can ensure that you get a copy. Yes.
Quick question regarding Kamasia. CIA report yesterday indicated that an intelligence officer asked the Pentagon in 1991 to relay to them if there were troops near the area at Kamasia, but that there was no response given. Is the Pentagon checking out why, as the accountability of that question?
Well, you know, we've got actually got two rather large investigations going on regarding some of the aspects of Camisea. The first one is being done by the Army IG, and we expect that that will be done sometime this summer. And the Army IG is looking into all of the activities associated with Camisea that that Army troops were involved in. That is destruction of weapons, what units were involved, where they were, all those kinds of things. The other report that's being done right now is by the intelligence oversight people here in the building, and it has to do with what intelligence was at hand in connection with Camisea when the intelligence information was disseminated, who it was disseminated to, all the kinds of questions that arise as a result of some of the documents that were released yesterday. And Dr. Rosker, who is running our Gulf War illnesses investigations, he has asked the Army IG to look into the matter that you just mentioned there. The other thing that I want to point out also, though, I think it's worth noting in connection with Camisea. I think some of you who have talked to unit commanding officers who were there at the time, some of you who attended the hearings where General Schwarzkopf was present, are aware that the number one concern that General Schwarzkopf had with regard to the entire Gulf War had to do with chemical weapons. And as a result, he had provided very clear guidance to his commanders that this was certainly a threat and one that the troops should take into consideration any time they encountered Iraqi units or Iraqi facilities. And we know from some of the conversations that we've had with people who were at Camisea that certainly unit commanders were very much aware of this and had taken steps to protect themselves, both in terms of the MOP gear that they had troops in, the detectors that they had deployed to determine if there were any evidences of chemical agents in the area at the time. And so those kinds of things were being done, despite the fact that not all of the intelligence got down to the unit commanders who were involved in these activities at Camisea.
Commander, one follow-up?
Yes.
Yes. As you said, that since you are in process to participate in the joint military exercise between Israel and Turkey, could you please check for me if in the text of the proposed agreement the other two contracting parties have included also the Greek island of Gavdos, G-A-V-D-O-S, and if those exercises will take also in the Aegean Sea and in the vicinity of the Republic of Cyprus?
Let me see what we can find out, but again, I think the problem that I have in answering your question is that it is so preliminary at this point. The outlines of the exercise are so preliminary at this point. I'm not sure that we have identified the location that the exercise is going to take place.
One more question, since we're in the process to invest to find out what's going on. According to DOD legal experts, it's prohibited by the law for DOD to participate in exercises when the contracting parties include illegally in the agreement a soil of another country allied to the U.S. Could you please confirm this legal citation?
Well, I would certainly agree that we are not going to be involved in exercises where the exercise takes place in an area where we have not been invited or do not have the authority to exercise.
This statement applies also to my question as far as for the island of Gabados.
Well, let me, before I answer that, I don't accept your premise that that island is a part of this exercise. We will try and make a determination, but let us look into that. I believe that at this point, the exercise is in such a preliminary stage that we don't know exactly where the exercise is going to be taking place.
For your information, it's not only one exercise. They say it will be eight of them around the year of 1997. That's why I'm very concerned as far as what is going on with the particular
island. Well, we'll look into it and see if we can get any further insights into it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.